Welcome to Twin Peaks, The Gifted
and The Damned
podcast. My name is Bubba. You can find me on Twitter at Fit and Trim. That's
F-I-T-T-E-N-T-R-I-M.
That's at Fit and Trim on Twitter. And with me, as always, my white lodge to my black lodge.
Hell yeah.
It's Mork. Mork, how you doing?
I'm doing great. I am doing great. How are you, Bubba?
I am doing well. We're going to finally talk about a podcast we've been talking about forever.
Mm-hmm.
And how can people, when they possibly disagree with your points, how can people find you on Twitter, Mork?
Well, I only make short declarative sentences, so I'm not sure how anyone would ever disagree with me, but you can track me down on Twitter at Extraordinary. That's extraordinary with the W in front of the last R.
Yes, and let me say that today on the podcast, we're going to be having spoilers for all of Twin Peaks, Fire Walk With Me, all of the Twin Peaks books, Mulholland Drive, the TV series The Fugitive, Dallas, the TV
Somebody's
show
marriage.
The Prisoner. We're going to be spoiling a lot of stuff. If you're not caught up on Twin Peaks, we apologize, but this Twin Peaks is for the gifted and the damned, this podcast is. Let me also say, if you're into shows like The Strain, Game of Thrones, Ash vs. Evil Dead, or many others, go to our Facebook page, facebook.com/doublepodcast, because we do a lot of podcasts, a lot of different subjects. We'd like you to join with us. Today's podcast is what, Mork, I like to call a double D.
A double D?
A double dose of fun.
Oh, I love fun.
First,
fun is so good.
First up, we're going to finally...
Hashtag finally.
...present our podcast essay, arguing against, oh boy, series co-creator and legendary director David Lynch.
Who?
Never heard of him. David Lynch, Gordon Cole, you heard of him?
Oh, right. Okay, yeah.
So, David Lynch, still to this day, he believes that revealing Laura Palmer's killer back in the original series was a mistake that ended up killing the show.
That's what killed the show, huh?
That's what he says.
Sweeps.
Thank you, Mork. And we are going to disagree with him, argue with him.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. So we are going the other way. And it's not just feedback from us. We've got great feedback from a Twin Peaks historian, Joel Bacco, as well as some other users, including one going by the great username of Laughing Pine Cone.
Laughing Pine Cone sounds something that might be attempted to you in Amsterdam.
You have to pay extra to get the Laughing Pine Cone.
Yeah, but I look forward to that anyway. Never been to Amsterdam, unlike you and Catfish.
That's true. But guess what else we're going to do?
Is that all?
No.
Oh, boy.
You know, we are going to begin our countdown to season three by doing our own Twin Peaks review of the Twin Peaks pilot and the next episode where it all began.
Yeah.
But because we've heard from you, our double L's.
Double L's?
Yeah, loyal listeners.
Okay.
We heard that you don't want a typical episode recap review podcast. So we're going to take a spin on it. We're going to lovingly rip off the classic Star Wars Minute podcast.
All right.
What we're going to do is we're going to look at the pilot and the very next episode. We're going to select the best 60 seconds, the best minute, and the worst minute of each.
Right.
We want to see if you agree. We want your feedback on what your favorite minute of the pilot is, favorite minute of the next episode directed by Dwayne Dunham. We want to know. Let us know. We'll also be reading your iTunes review and feedback. We'll continue our sad, ridiculous journey of describing real-life encounters with Twin Peaks celebrities.
To be fair, it's only sad and ridiculous for the Twin Peaks celebrities.
Right, not for us. No.
No, it's for them. How far have they fallen? For us, it's a good day.
Yes. It's going to be a great podcast, but yeah. Mork, we got to start it off with sad news. Just a couple of days ago from when we're recording this, R.I.P. Miguel Ferrer, a.k.a. Albert Rosenfield.
Good old Albert.
He was only 61. Is that so young?
It's very young. I did not even know he was sick.
What is truly sad, because you don't think about things like this, but at the TCA event, which we covered on the last podcast, he was supposed to be there on stage with Kyle MacLachlan,
with the other Twin Peaks
celebrities.
Well, God bless Miguel.
So, Mork, I think we have to get to it right at the top. Did you have a favorite Albert moment from Twin Peaks or Fire Walk With Me? I know I had several. What was your favorite?
I mean, most of, he was great. Most of the favorite moments are just looking at him and just, he just needed to give a look. And he was great because he was such a wonderful change up to the rest of the rhythm of the show, but he still fit within the show, you know, perfectly.
Perfectly.
And probably the best was when he declared his love for Harry Truman.
Oh man,
that was magical, and it was coming at a very tense part. I mean, we're in the middle of really the final parts of the investigation. There's a lot going on. The stakes couldn't be higher, and boom, he plants one on Truman's cheek. It was beautiful.
That is a great moment. I have to say that of all the wonderful Albert moments, and you were right. He could just give a look. When Big Ed is telling his story about his trip with Nadine, his looks are brilliant.
Yeah.
My favorite moment is still his very first appearance.
Right.
You nailed it so much. He is such a change of pace. He's going so quick, unlike the Twin Peaks characters. He's interrupting. He's cutting off. He's proving...
He's rude.
He's proving in every aspect that he is the anti-Twin Peaks.
Right.
Character, and yet you are 100% right. He fit in the humor that scene created with the great capper of Harry looking to Cooper and Cooper giving him that preposterous thumbs up.
Yeah, and the fact that Coop loved him definitely goes a long way. And so he was fantastic. I mean, this could be an entire episode, but
oh, true.
I definitely think that if they redid the show, if they started over today, then there would be more Albert or more people like Albert on the show. And that would not be a bad thing in my mind.
No, that is a great point. One thing that I always thought about, if you're new to the series, we always talk about how we're old-timey fans who were there at the very beginning. If you pay attention, Albert, you know, not only is he sporadic, he just pops up. There even comes a point where David Lynch's Gordon Cole character comes up and says, Albert Rosenfield will not be returning to Twin Peaks. Why he says that is because Miguel was so great in his appearance in season one as Albert that he was given the lead of his own show called Broken Badges on CBS. And he was the lead and he was going to have his own, exactly, he was going to have his own show. Sadly, or maybe... Luckily for us in the Twin Peaks community, that show didn't last, and so they were able to get him back and have him do more episodes. He will be missed. Really good. Yeah. Were there any other roles that Miguel Ferrer played over his incredible career that really stand out to you, Mork? I want to jump in with one, and that is in the miniseries The Stand by Stephen King. Uh-huh. We've mentioned it on previous podcasts, but Albert played a character, quote-unquote, on the bad side, but he was actually one of my favorite characters from the book that Miguel got to play, and he just did great in that miniseries, The Stand. He was great, this is going to sound silly, in Hot Shots Part 2. You know, he could do comedy. He was great on the air in Lynch Frost, one of their other series. So, so many great roles.
Yeah, I mean, he did... I mean, the first time I remember thinking to myself, who is that guy, was in the original RoboCop.
Oh, yes. And so many people on Twitter have been celebrating him
on RoboCop. You know, because he was so sleazy. I can't remember if RoboCop came out before or after. It came out about the same time as Die Hard. Mm-hmm. But was it Bob Morton in RoboCop? Was that his character's name? But it was Miguel Ferrer in RoboCop or Hart Bochner in Die Hard. It's like, in RoboCop, he was actually killing people.
Right.
And like, you saw him. I mean, they're both coked up, but you saw him committing far more evil deeds. But they were both so wonderful and slimy. He was fantastic. He was electric, and he'll be missed, but we'll always be able to watch him on amazing movies and TV.
That's true. And in upcoming season 3, we're going to get to watch him, hopefully, a lot. He will be missed. This is so sad. We've lost so many of the great Twin Peaks actors over the years. But luckily, Miguel is going to be in season 3 for us fans. And it's just incredibly, incredibly exciting to know that we're going to get to see him again and celebrate his work again.
Yeah.
One other bit of news we want to talk about right here at the top is Showtime, since our last podcast, released a mini trailer for Twin Peaks where they finally show Cooper in character. They finally show him. He's just coming out of the black. He looks all of 26 years later.
Right.
Did you have any thoughts about that, Mork? What do you think when you see 25 years later, Coop? I think probably for me, sorry, I'm asking you a question then interrupting, but for me, I watched this video. It felt like 10 times. I'm looking at that pin on his jacket, which maybe implies he's still in the FBI.
Mm-hmm.
And he definitely looks old. it was a thrill to see Coop back in action.
Yeah, well, I mean, he's not doing a whole lot. I mean, the things that you know, obviously you think about are, okay, he's coming out of the black, so is he coming out of the Black Lodge?
Mm-hmm.
So what is that exactly? He does look, I mean, if you know, when you think about the original scenes in the Red Room, where his skin, which right. was supposed to be 25 years in the future, and his skin was, you know, so leathery, and, you know, obviously people, they didn't know about Botox in the original series. So, but no, he looks good. He looks like he looks grim, which we don't really associate with Coop. So it's kind of like, all right, well, what are we going to see here? Black Lodge, or is that just a shadow? We don't know. And also, the population did not seem to really change at all. So I'm curious
on the
that.
Sign there. Yeah, welcome the sign. To Twin Peaks.
Yeah, it seems pretty close.
One other thing I noted about this promo, other than getting me so jazzed, mm-hmm. is we talk about how actors just are naturally going to look different.
Uh-huh.
This Twin Peaks is going to be in HD as opposed to the one everybody's familiar with now in standard definition. Plus,
right. mm-hmm.
this Twin Peaks is going to be shot in HD video versus film. And as somebody who this is partially around my career working in HD video and that kind of things, I could tell that it actually didn't look like film and it was different. And I wonder in some ways if I'll be such a snob if that'll affect my enjoyment of it at all. Probably not, because once again, I watched this promo 10 times and it was like, holy smokes, look at Coop.
Yeah, I don't think it will. And I do think that, you know, Lynch has a lot of, you know, he's very familiar. He's shot a lot in HD and video. So I don't think it's going to be a limitation to him at all, but it will be different and it will feel different. And maybe if they shot on film and certain things to make it look more like the original series, maybe they'll do that. Maybe they won't. I don't know. We shall see.
Well, May is going to get here quicker than we know, and yet it'll be so painful waiting for May to come around. So we have gone very long, and it's time to bring out this week's special guest. He's somebody.
Is he up from his nap?
Oh, boy. We're going to have to get him over. Come on over.
Yeah.
It's our special guest on the podcast, Mayor Dwayne Milford.
Hello, Mayor. How are you?
Gentlemen, if I could have your attention.
You have our attention, sure.
Is this thing on? Is this thing on?
Yes, sir.
It's working. It is on. It is. We can hear you.
Yes.
Mayor?
Hello?
Mayor, you are joining us. We're recording this the day after the inauguration. Any thoughts on...
Were you at the inauguration?
We have all shared today in the grief.
That's pretty tough.
Mm-hmm.
The grief that flies to death. And this grief is attended by fear. And tonight, it preoccupies us. Is this thing on? Is this thing on?
Mayor Milford, thank you so much for being here. We're going to come to you throughout the podcast for some of your experience, which is really top notch.
Best to Lana.
Hey, it is time to talk about your iTunes reviews.
Yay!
So we have 4 new reviews this week. So exciting. If you are kind enough to give us a written iTunes review mm-hmm. and go to our Facebook page, that's facebook.com/PP podcast, the word double, the single letter P, the word podcast, plural, facebook.com/PP podcast, like the Facebook page and give us a iTunes review. You are eligible to win one of our contests. So, Mark, why don't you read this first one we have off in the USA iTunes store?
Oh, perfect day to start with the USA. Great Twin Peaks discussion. 5 beautiful stars. Look at that.
Woo-hoo.
And it's from Concerned Musician 22. I've really been enjoying the discussions about the secret history of Twin Peaks. I listened to the audiobook while at work.
blow off work, Concerned Musician.
Yeah,
we love you.
Thanks a lot. So I would occasionally miss some of the finer details, so it's nice to have something to fill in the gaps in an entertaining way. Keep it up and thanks. Thank you, Concerned Musician.
Heck yeah. Let me read another one from the USA iTunes store. This is from Uncle Twitchy. It's a damn fine podcast and hot. 5 stars. Thank
Hell
you
yeah.
so much. Uncle Twitchy writes, listening to these guys talk about Twin Peaks reminds me of my friends and I discussing the show back in the day. Hey.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Funny, clever, insightful. I'm making my way through their discussions of the new Mark Frost book and really look forward to see what they have to say come May and the new season. Thank you so much, Uncle Twitchy.
Oh, Uncle Twitchy, you're the best. Here's another one from the 48 contiguous states. Great find. 5 stars. Oh, my gosh. That's amazing. A very lucky shark says, so happy I stumbled upon this podcast about Twin Peaks and associated books, film, etc. It's got a great balance of serious discussion and humor.
Woohoo!
Keep up the great work.
We will try to. We have one other new iTunes review. It's from the UK iTunes store.
Wow.
It's from, I'm going to mispronounce this. I apologize. It's from Hyab-X. Title of the review is Better Than a Square Dance and a Hayride.
Wow.
4 stars. So thank you very much. We'll try to earn that 5th star.
Yeah, but hayrides and square dances are like maybe 1 star each. So
just barely better.
Yeah, we'll take it. We'll take it.
They write, I found this podcast as I was looking for a discussion and commentary for The Secret History of Twin Peaks book by Mark Frost, which led me to these two jokers. No, seriously, a humorous and fun recording that Bubba and Mork have put together examining the mysteries of the aforementioned work, the show, and the movie. It's hard not to like the commentary, even though it doesn't necessarily dig too deeply into the source material within. A small pity for an otherwise well-produced and entertaining podcast. Keep up the good work, fellas. Ooh, thank you so much.
Wow.
We've said it before, we'll say it again, that if we ever do anything, and we're going to, that's going to make you want to unsubscribe in anger to our wrong, silly positions and stupid ideas. What do you need to do if you want to unsubscribe, Mork?
Well, I mean, it'd be a completely futile gesture to try to unsubscribe if they haven't subscribed first. So they have to do it.
Right.
They should do it now.
Please review and subscribe on iTunes. We really need it. Thank you so much. And you'll be eligible to win a prize, which will be given away another prize on our next month podcast, the first one of February. I want to mention something, Mork, and this is a bit embarrassing.
No, it's not.
We had a great review from somebody. If you just read it, the name, it was kind of funny. If you actually broke it down, it was from Very Bad Ideas.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Bad Ideas.
Right. And so we tried to read it as like, Bid Idea. Like it was a name. And sure enough, last week on the podcast, or the last podcast we did, we gave away a signed copy of The Secret History of Twin Peaks, autographed by co-creator and author Mark Frost, as well as season 3 actress Amy Shields.
Yeah.
And so we did it at the very end of the podcast, and I read the name. I was like, John Partimer.
Oh, no.
And I actually went back and looked at the name because they haven't contacted us yet about where to mail it. And I realized
Part-timer?
That it was John Partimer. So John Partimer, you won this special I'm a buffoon. You won this special copy of The Secret History of Twin Peaks, autographed by Mark Frost and Amy Shields. So you got to contact us, either tweet at us or go to our Facebook page, give us your mailing address,
and we will send this out to you.
So before we dig into our main topic today about revealing the killer being the right thing and reviewing the pilot and the first episode of Twin Peaks, it's time for another edition of We Have an Interaction with a Real Life Twin Peaks cast member, and we tell the story.
All right.
So, Mork, I was moved
jogging.
Out. Mork, I moved out to L.A., and I left behind a bunch of friends of mine from the Chicago improv community, and I moved out to L.A., and slowly and surely, they started moving out, but it was a couple of years later.
You were the pioneer.
I was one of the pioneers, and so they were a couple of years later, and so you know how sometimes you don't see your friends for a while?
Sure.
In a new city, it can be odd, and so my friend Terry, who'd moved out to L.A. back in Illinois, he had been a parole officer, believe it or not. He moves
Hell
out to
yeah.
L.A. to follow his dream to be an actor.
Good.
And our other buddy Chris said, hey, it's Terry's birthday.
Mm-hmm.
Terry is going to be going to this karaoke bar, this world-famous karaoke bar called Dimples over in Burbank.
Excellent.
Just, you know, nowadays.
It's like on top of a bridge, isn't
it? Yes, but it just got torn down. They're replacing it with condos. World-famous Dimples and L.A.
Oh,
Hollywood institution.
Where is that creepy old man going to hit on 18-year-old girls?
Well, I still go to... Oh, wait, no.
No, the really creepy old man. You think he's still alive?
I cannot say, but they've torn down Dimples. It was a famous place. They do karaoke there all the time. So it's Terry's birthday. We're going to all go to Dimples, but first we're going to meet at some friend of Terry's house. We're going to meet at this house to meet Terry and then go to Dimples and go. And so I pick up my buddy Chris, and we're driving to this friend's house. And of course, at this time, we're, you know, young hipsters in our 20s. We're like, hey, let's go pick up some ladies at this karaoke bar, Dimples, and we're going to do all these things. We pull over to this little Hollywood house, these little bungalows in Burbank. And these houses are small, you know, they're kind of little craftsman homes that you see, and they're really cute. So we walk up, knock on the door. We open on the door to Terry's friend whose house we're all meeting at. And of course, who opens the door? Bobby Briggs.
Hell yeah.
My friend Terry. His friend is Dana Ashbrook, the actor who plays Bobby Briggs.
Amazing.
And I'm just being welcomed into his house.
What'd you steal?
Let me tell you something. I pulled the Bubba. I did some really dumb. So if people have listened to all of our Gifted and Damned podcasts, they'll know that I actually met the actress Charlotte Stewart, who played his mother on the show, Betty Briggs, through my work. And here I am. I'm out and I'm walking into Dana Ashbrook, Bobby Briggs' house.
That's awesome.
And in the previous story, I had mentioned how it took me forever to finally get up the guts to say, hey, Charlotte, are you Betty Briggs? So I'm in this house, and it is Bobby Briggs. It is Dana Ashbrook's house. He's the one opening the door, welcoming me in. And it's him.
Yeah.
Now, at this point, he has gone gray. And this story is about a decade old. I, of course, am suddenly like, inside, Twin Peaks super geek fan that I am, is just going nuts. I'm looking around the house. I'm meeting what I assume was his wife. I can't even remember if it was his wife, his girlfriend, who this person was. I was just looking around the house for Twin Peaks paraphernalia. But also at the same time, I'm like, play it cool.
Play it cool.
Don't creep about.
Play it cool.
So, you know, they're offering us drinks. We're waiting to go out to Dibbles. And of course, I'm like, not talking to try to play him cool and not seem like a Twin Peaks super fan. I'm not talking to him at all. I'm like, not saying I'm talking to once again this woman, his wife, his girlfriend, to the other people there.
That's the key thing when you're trying to.
Oh my lord! It was pitiful.
When you're trying to make friends with a Twin Peaks actor, ignore them and hit on their wife.
No, I was not hitting on Mork. Can I tell the true version of the story, please?
All right, I'm gonna imagine you're still hitting on your wife.
Okay, so
yawning and stretching.
But my thought process is okay. Once we go to Dimples, once we've all had a few drinks and we're out, I'll let my Peaks freak flag fly. I'll ask him all the questions I want to. And so, sure enough, after about hanging out at Dana Ashbrook's house for about a half hour, we all go over to Dimples.
Yep.
And as much as I am a Twin Peaks super freak and fan, the plan always was to, okay, once we get to Dimples, there are always girls having their birthday parties there.
Sure.
You know, go pick up some ladies.
Right.
And so I'm a single man in my late 20s. I'm like, all right, let's go meet these ladies.
Sure.
And honest to God, we hadn't even been at Dimples an hour when Dana and his wife left and went back to their home.
Because you weren't even talking to them.
Maybe that was it.
They're sitting there. No one cares about Twin Peaks.
Well, like,
the show just went off the air.
No,
I'm
the show
Bobby
didn't.
Briggs.
The show didn't just go off the air, Mark. You know, he's probably a decade older than us or whatever. So he left and went home. He's like, you know, okay, this is a young person's game for people on the make.
Yeah.
And so literally, you know, I finally have enough liquid courage to go up and start talking. And I'd been flirting with all these girls. And I'm like, all right, sure. Where'd Dana go? Is he singing on stage? No, where'd he go? Oh, they left. And I was the big downer for the rest of this party.
Well,
I ruined Terry's birthday party at Dimples.
You didn't go back to Dana's house and knock on his door and start asking him those questions? So I forgot to ask him, David.
I totally blew it. If you want to unsubscribe from the podcast right now, as a Twin Peaks super fan, I totally blew this. A buffoon. Oh, my lord.
Clearly a buffoon.
Oh,
yes.
My lord. How
but
stupid am
the
I?
The one way you can redeem yourself.
Yeah, let's hear this.
Because basically, what you owe all of our double L's.
Double L's?
Loyal listeners. What you owe them.
Yeah.
Is a story. And
I do. That isn't a story, but that was my real life interaction with Dana Ashbrook.
You didn't get a story. So
I didn't get one.
Now they have the right and the willpower. You know, they're the captains of their own destiny. So I think what you owe to them is Dana Ashbrook's home address.
All right, I will. This is about a decade ago. I went to this birthday party. All right, I will see what I can do. I will contact my friend Terry to
see if we can publish and also his social security number.
I'll see what I can do, listeners. If you want to tweet hate at me for being such an idiot, once again, my Twitter handle is @fitandtrim. That's FitenTrim @fitandtrim on Twitter. That was pitiful. I apologize, listeners.
That was terrible, Bubba. We blame you.
Okay, so let's jump in. Let's dive in to the crux, to the meat of these podcasts.
This is the big one.
We're going to jump in on a big thing that I've been bouncing around forever. And so if you're a listener to the podcast, you may be asking yourself,
Why am I a listener of this podcast? Yeah,
that's a question you always ask yourself, but you might be thinking, you know, this is 17 years after the fact. They revealed the killer who killed Laura Palmer in 1990.
Mm-hmm.
Why in the world is a 2017 podcast bothering to talk about this? Why is a podcast going out and calling brilliant film auteur David Lynch wrong?
Sure.
And David Lynch is saying things like, he never wanted to answer who killed Laura Palmer, and it was wrong to solve the murder mystery, and he said it was killing the goose that laid the golden egg. So why in the world will we do a podcast about this? Well, the main reason for me is that David Lynch keeps saying it. We did that very first podcast about why Twin Peaks was canceled, because the Wikipedia page and so many other people kind of don't understand why it was canceled.
Right.
And I wanted to break that down. And listen, obviously, we love David Lynch's work. Twin Peaks is my favorite TV show of all time. We're dedicating our lives to this podcast.
Literally our entire lives.
Amen. But him keep saying this thing, obviously everybody's opinion is what it is, but I feel that that is so wrong that I had to do a podcast about it. And I specifically, you know, how this kind of bleeds to other people. There's this great blog on the internet by a guy named Hussein Ibish. I hope I'm pronouncing that right.
All right.
And it's a great little blog post. And he was this guy who had this great theory that at the end of Fire Walk With Me, when Laura's face is kind of illuminated by this blue light while she's there in the Red Room, Black Lodge, whatever, it was her watching the TV show, the lives of her friends after she died and laughing at their foils and things. And it's this great blog. So
good. Invitation to Love.
Yeah. But in the middle of this blog, this guy writes this paragraph, which I consider either just wrong opinions, wrong spin, or just flat out wrong, that it drove me crazy. So I want to read this. And Hussein writes, as the program Twin Peaks entered its second season, Lynch came under heavy pressure from the network and his co-author Mark Frost to reveal the secret of Laura Palmer's killer. Lynch argued there was no obligation to the audience to resolve the question and that it should remain a mystery until the end of the series, if not beyond. Unfortunately, fairly into the second season, the network won out, as they do, and it was revealed that Laura had been murdered by her own father following years of sexual abuse at home. Predictably enough, Lynch was right. The revelation removed the central theme around which the story had been constructed, and the series veered wildly off track. It was not renewed. The collapse of Twin Peaks also occurred partially because Lynch plainly lost interest in it after his idea of a completely open-ended series fell by the wayside. It goes on, but there are so many things in this paragraph that this very intelligent, smart person writes that's wrong.
Yeah.
So, oh my God. Unfortunately, fairly early into the second season, the network won out. That, I apologize, is wrong. The decision to reveal Laura's killer was made before they even wrote the second season. It wasn't fairly into it. They knew, as soon as they started creating the second season, okay, we're going to reveal the killer in November sweeps. He says Lynch was right. Now, that's an opinion, nothing against that. But he believes that's what caused the series to veer wildly off track. I completely disagree.
Yeah.
He says that Lynch plainly lost interest in it after his idea of a completely open-ended series fell by the wayside. What are you talking about? The series was still open-ended.
Right.
So I am going crazy. And this craziness actually goes back to 1990, where Lynch himself, you know, he's saying it now. He said this in 1990. He said, closure. I keep hearing that word. It's the theater of the absurd. Everybody knows that on television, they'll see the end of the story in the last 15 minutes of the thing. It's like a drug. To me, that's the beauty of Twin Peaks. We throw in some curveballs. As soon as you have a sense of closure, it gives you an excuse to forget you've seen the damn thing.
Yeah, that, I mean, I part of what I don't like about that is it feels, and this could be the reason why the show was so good, but and TV is a lot different now. I mean, we really are in the golden age of it. But, you know, there is this sort of, you know, subtext. It sort of feels like all television is kind of disposable in Lynch's mind. And so what, you know, they set out to do something that, you know, I don't know if they set out to do it, but they did make something that obviously lasted a very, very long time.
Yeah.
You know, closure is one thing, but, yeah, I mean, it's... Sorry.
Hey, listen, we love David Lynch. I'm going to keep repeating that. And if you disagree, if you think, you know what, David Lynch is the artist, he's the one who created it, the artist should have complete control. If that's your opinion, there's nothing we're going to say that's going to disagree with you. There's nothing that we're going to say where you're going to go, oh, well, okay.
Yeah.
And we understand that. And that's certainly a fine platform to stand on.
I mean, there's probably no good reasons Probably no good reasons at all, but maybe you can think of just one, Bubba. Just one reason why maybe it was the right thing to do.
Well, Mork, I'm going to give you seven.
Oh, my God.
I'm going to give you seven reasons, right, and me. I'm even going to take on your note, the artist is king. Sure enough, but this is called show business. When Twin Peaks got canceled, people lost their jobs. This is a real business,
yeah.
And so I'm going to give you seven reasons why.
All right.
I believe
seven.
Lynch is wrong. And if you disagree with any of these points, Mork, you let me know.
Oh, I will.
First one is I'm just going to go big picture.
Okay.
Storytelling reasons.
Okay.
There's this thing that I believe most people have heard of. It's called the three-act structure.
All right.
It's a storytelling device that divides a narrative into three parts, often called the setup, the confrontation, the resolution, also the beginning, middle, and end. This has been around since Greek times. In fact, Aristotle put forth that a whole is what has a beginning, a middle, and an end.
Hmm.
So the Greeks believed this.
Okay.
It actually got updated in Roman times to where these people started pushing for a five-act structure where it was exposition, rising action, climax, falling action, denouement.
Denouement.
So even in ancient times, people, when they were told the story, they wanted an ending. They wanted a resolution.
And TV was bad then.
They wanted answers, I'm telling you. They wanted answers.
Yeah.
And so, this is a snide, sarcastic comment. To say people want answers, why do you think things like the Bible exist? People want answers. And if you look at just a popular kind of writing online, writing courses online, one of the things I pulled out, it says to the degree to which your ending is enshrouded in mystery can vary, but you do need to offer some resolution. And be careful to avoid in endings that are so vague the reader doesn't have any indication of what to make of it. A definitive resolution is part of what makes a story an actual story, as opposed to an anecdote or merely a collection of actions strung together.
Yeah.
So the general idea of storytelling is a beginning, middle, and end. I'm going to go back to the three-point structure. And while I understand that rules are meant to be broken, and listen, I love breaking rules.
Mm-hmm.
In this instance, people wanted an end. Twin Peaks was once again financed by commercials. If you don't bring enough eyeballs in to something, it stops.
Yeah.
That's it. That was the way TV used to work. Ratings were everything.
Yeah, it wasn't like the show, and just to kind of like underscore your point a little bit, it wasn't like the show was a number one in the ratings every week until they revealed the killer.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
And then it fell off the cliff. It was barely alive. It was barely alive from basically episode two. So, you know, the idea that that's what killed it, no. It was in the shitter for a long time, and it, you know, finally it just went down the drain.
It just couldn't go on anymore. But, no, sorry, Mork. You're getting to my reason number two.
Oh, son of a...
Ratings.
Yes.
Now, if you listen to our very first podcast, we went deep on the Twin Peaks ratings here on The Gifted and the
Damned.
Where's
that British guy?
Exactly right. But to give you, if you haven't listened to that podcast, or to just give you a review, I'm going to give you the Cliff Notes, Spark Notes version of that thing. And that is exactly what Mork just said. It barely got a second season. It barely got picked up after the first season. And it got picked up and put on Saturday night. That's how bad the ratings were. ABC demanded that Twin Peaks reveal the killer. And they decided, this show is in such ratings trouble, let's do it during sweeps. It was dying, dying, dying. The October 20th episode, which is a couple episodes before they revealed the killer. This is Leland under arrest for Jacques Renault's murder.
Mm-hmm.
It was ranked 71 out of the 90 primetime network show. 71. The following week, October 27th, this was an episode that featured the rescue of Audrey from One-Eyed Jacks.
Oh, that probably went through the roof.
75th.
Oh,
75 out of 94 primetime. Those are god-awful, very bad, not good ratings, which would, let me say this again, would have gotten Twin Peaks pulled off the schedule immediately. And sure enough, we mentioned this on the previous podcast, a critically acclaimed show called China Beach was on ABC
right
before Twin Peaks.
Mm-hmm.
It tanked in November sweeps, and ABC pulled it.
Yeah.
Now, China Beach, once again, this was respected. It's in
it
that.
It's a great show, yeah.
Yeah, this is in Alan Sepinwall's book about the 100 greatest TV shows of all time.
Yeah.
Yet because China Beach bombed in that sweeps period, it was yanked off the air in December, and they didn't put it back on the air until June. So think about this. Twin Peaks aired all the way up until June of 1991.
Yeah.
China Beach got pulled in November, and it didn't air its remaining episodes until all of the Twin Peaks episodes had aired. That's how long it was off the schedule.
Uh-huh.
That's what would have happened to Twin Peaks if, in November, that episode revealing the killer hadn't boosted the ratings up to 51. Like, that is why Twin Peaks survived three more months. Mark, what I'm saying is that there is no way the Twin Peaks fandom would exist as it did today if the show had been off the air for 6 months like China Beach was.
There is
no way. We keep mentioning we need your iTunes reviews because we're going to give you a prize and because it helps us stand out among the 100 current Twin Peaks podcasts. If Twin Peaks had a six-month break and, you know, really waited a long time to, you know, ever get to the end, aka reveal the killer, Twin Peaks as we know it now would not exist. It wouldn't have these fans. We wouldn't have had the movie. We wouldn't have had anything.
But we still would have been asking you for votes
right.
and promising a prize.
Right. We still ask you for reviews.
Let's not lose sight of that.
So for storytelling reasons, you needed to reveal the killer. For ratings and for the life of the show and these people's jobs, you needed to reveal the killer. I now want to go to my third point.
Okay.
And this is the format of the show.
Okay.
And this is where sometimes people, including the creators running the show, cannot understand what they have.
Okay.
Lynch and Frost, way back in 1990, still to this day, they always talked about how the murder mystery, who killed Laura Palmer, was supposed to be a hook to pull viewers in.
Yeah.
But then viewers would get invested in the character's storylines and the murder mystery would fall to the background.
The storylines like Big Ed and Nadine?
Right. Mm-hmm. And it would be more a show like the TV show The Fugitive.
Oh.
And once again, we're going to spoil The Fugitive. The idea of The Fugitive is that Richard Kimball has been arrested for killing his wife.
Yeah.
He's able to get away from jail, and he runs to look for the person who killed his wife, the one-armed man. And so that was...
Was it OJ? Sorry.
American Crime Story. Sarah Paulson, how could you? But in that show, you know, Lynch and Frost talked about it because you didn't see the fugitive catch the one-armed man until the very last episode of The Fugitive.
Right.
So, yes, this was a show that ran from 1963 to 1967, four seasons. So four seasons, theoretically, The Fugitive is about Richard Kimball looking for the one-armed man who actually killed his wife.
Yeah, but not occasionally.
Right.
Occasionally.
Thank you, Mork. So that is where Lynch and Frost, when they try to use this analogy, are completely wrong. It's like they don't understand the format of their show versus the format of The Fugitive.
Right.
Now, The Fugitive itself was built into Twin Peaks' DNA. The character of the one-armed man, Mike, Philip Gerard, was...
Agent Gerard.
Right. He was originally a character on the TV show, The Fugitive.
Or Lieutenant Gerard.
Right. And so Lynch, in the pilot of making Twin Peaks, he had originally, before the European ending, he just had this actor with one arm on the elevator with Coop and Sheriff Truman as a winking nod to that show.
Right.
But that show was really different. Those episodes, yes, he was always looking for the one-armed man, and he didn't find him till four seasons later. But the individual episodes had a beginning, middle, and end.
Uh-huh.
Let me read you some descriptions of actual fugitive episodes. So here's an episode. It says, employed as a building super, Dr. Richard Kimball befriends a troubled youth in the building who steals a key from him to attack a woman in her apartment.
Well, that's not nice.
Yeah, it's not nice. But guess what? It also has nothing to do with the one-armed man searching for him.
Did the troubled youth kill his wife?
No, believe it or not,
okay.
No.
All right.
Sorry. Why don't you read another? Just pick another.
All right. Okay. So while working for a small town veterinarian, Dr. Kimball comes across the sick baby of an unwed mother whose religious father doesn't believe in medicine. As Kimball secretly treats the baby, a jealous, dismissed deputy discovers his true identity. Oh, maybe the deputy killed Kimball's...
No, didn't
kill the wife?
So... what we're trying to explain is that, yes, the fugitive didn't actually catch the one-armed man until four years later.
Yeah.
But they were giving you stories with beginning, middle, end, and resolution every week.
They weren't
leaving you hanging in any sort of way.
Yeah, no, there was a payoff.
And Twin Peaks wasn't that. If you watch that great first season, which everybody loves, there was no resolution to any storyline in season one, save perhaps Nadine's storyline of a woman who wants to make a silent drape runner, gets rejected and then kills herself. That's a sad storyline, but that is a resolution to that storyline. Everything else acted like a soap opera. They didn't create a show like The Fugitive. They may say they wanted their show to be like The Fugitive. It was nothing like The Fugitive.
Right.
And what drives me crazy about that quote more is that their idea that viewers would get pulled into the other characters' storylines. Most of the characters were focused on solving Laura's killer.
Right, because they all knew her, because she touched everyone in the town's life.
Right, so it wasn't just the cops looking for Laura's killer. You also had Donna, James, and Maddie's storyline about...
Wait, her best friend, her boyfriend, and her cousin wanted to know who killed her?
Yes.
What?
Audrey, her trip to One-Eyed Jack's. Yes, it kind of took the storyline in a new direction, but the underlying premise is she was doing it to help Cooper solve who killed Laura Palmer.
Exactly.
Everything about the show was, who killed Laura Palmer? Who killed Laura Palmer?
Right.
So how are viewers supposed to get involved in other storylines other than... Who killed Laura Palmer?
Who killed Laura? How did she die? And for most of the show, why?
Great point.
Why was she killed? Yeah. So
the writers had a chance to kind of spin away from the Laura Palmer murder mystery and give you other stories. And they certainly did that in the Ghostwood Estates, Ben, Catherine, Josie storyline. But to be honest, when they had chances to spin away, they didn't. At the beginning of season two, the Twin Peaks Sheriff's Department, Cooper, and even Albert, they go, you know what? The mill fire was an arson set by Leo Johnson.
Uh-huh.
Now, you find that out, but did the police spend any time? Did the FBI spend any time? Did anybody investigate why Leo burned the mill?
Right.
Certainly, they must have known that Leo would have been paid by somebody to burn the mill, and that could have been its own storyline to take us away from who killed Laura Palmer. But they don't. They stay focused
now,
on Laura's murder.
I just want to interrupt you for a real quick second. How long from after the mill burned down was he basically a vegetable? I mean, it wasn't that long.
No, yeah. It was the same episode where he gets shot by Hank.
Yeah.
But you could have, okay, he's a vegetable, but you could say, ooh, well, let's check his bank account. Let's see if somebody paid him.
Right.
And that's a way you could spin.
Let's look at his boots.
Exactly. That's a way you could spin the story away from who killed Laura Palmer into we got to investigate who's paying somebody to burn down the mill.
Exactly.
But they didn't do that. They never truly pivoted to these other stories that they wanted the audience to quote unquote focus on. Because of that, if you have this central thing and you're never giving people an answer to it, of course the viewers are going to get frustrated and slowly die away. And so once again, I'm talking about the format of the show. And so I want to look at, let's go with Lynch's argument. Let's say you go to a show where you don't give an answer until the very end. And I'm going to look at the classic no resolution show until the very last episode. The No Answers show is a British show entitled The Prisoner. Did you ever watch The Prisoner, Mork?
Yeah, something about a bicycle.
Right, yeah. What was it about?
Oh, I just know. The bicycle was like in the logo.
Yeah. There was something going on there. But anyway.
That's all I got. Sorry.
Oh, no, it's okay. The Prisoner, it lived and was made completely differently than Twin Peaks was. The Prisoner was made to air in Canada and the UK. It didn't have to sell commercials. It didn't sell advertising. Ratings were important, but they weren't the biggest thing.
Exactly.
The Prisoner didn't give you an answer until the final episode, and even that was a mystery. For The Prisoner, if you look at the entire series, it was just 17 episodes, aka 17 hours, The Prisoner was.
Right.
You know what else was 17 hours? If you watch Twin Peaks at the very beginning and go all the way to Leland killing Maddie and being revealed as Laura's killer, that's also exactly 17 hours.
Amazing.
So,
well done, Bubba.
Imagine you're selling the audience a murder mystery, but we're going to ask you to invest 17 hours to find out who did it.
Right.
Of course, people can't. You know, a lot of people wouldn't.
Well, we're about to invest 18 hours.
Right.
So.
Yeah, exactly. Of season three, 18 hours.
Yeah.
And so, yes, millions of viewers did drop off because they weren't getting that resolution in many storylines. Mm-hmm. And certainly not the biggest one. The only one that the show at times seemed to be interested in.
Right.
You weren't giving anybody a resolution of.
Yeah.
Twin Peaks was a soap opera. Let's go to number four.
Okay.
Let's talk about soap operas.
Yes.
And let's talk about the famous TV question before. Who killed Laura Palmer? What was it? It was, who shot JR? From the primetime soap opera, Dallas.
Oh, man, that was a good show.
Now, when you look at this Who Killed JR from what I call the 10,000-foot view, you may say, the episode where JR got shot, it aired on March 21st, yet they didn't reveal who shot JR until November 21st. And that's actually a longer duration of time than Twin Peaks revealed, because Twin Peaks premiered in April, revealed the killer on November 10th. So technically, Dallas viewers waited a longer period of time to find out who shot JR. And so, yes, that is technically true, But what you're missing is there was a writer's strike.
Yeah.
And the reason for the big delay was not because the Dallas writers were pushing off who did it. But there was just a strike, so no episodes came back. There were only 4 episodes. JR was shot in Dallas episode 54, which once again aired on March 21st of 1980. And on episode 58, 4 episodes later, which did admittedly air on November 21st, they revealed who it was. It
right.
was a
but there's
4-episode murder mystery.
It's a murder mystery, but also no one had any idea who shot. I mean, that's why it took the nation by storm, you know, because basically he gets shot. We don't know who. We don't know why. So it's a much, much different circumstance than what happened with Laura.
That's exactly right. There weren't clues. You
yeah.
couldn't, like, review
you
the tape. You couldn't search Bobby Ewing's dream to find out
right.
clues. And so why is that so important? Because the Dallas audience, while they did really, really want to know who shot JR, they couldn't. There was no reason to spend months and months analyzing frame by frame the thing.
Yeah.
There were no clues.
Yeah.
And so the audience wasn't kind of put to stress like the Twin Peaks audience was. Literally, the Twin Peaks audience had a character state about Cooper's dream. They're like, break the code, solve the crime. It was like a secret that the audience needed to do. And so the audience for months tried to. People were trying to solve who did it.
Yeah.
And so that, of course, raised the frustration level when they had to wait a full 17 hours to find out who did it.
Sure.
So let's jump to my 5th reason.
All right.
I just mentioned that we were told to break the code, look for clues. We had, once again, from April until November to figure out who killed Laura Palmer by breaking the code. And sure enough, most of the audience already knew who the killer was.
Yeah.
I'm going to read to you from an article from The New Yorker.
Oh, fancy. The New Yorker.
It's entitled, I'll Test My Log. It's from December 17th, 1990.
Okay.
And it's talking that at Florence Gould Hall in Uptown Manhattan hosted a fascinating seminar entitled Return to Twin Peaks. This was a moderated discussion featuring a number of Twin Peaks personalities. The seminar was advertised in an issue of Soap Opera Weekly. The advertisement was small, and the seminar quickly sold out. The venue could only accommodate 400 to 500 people. It had a panel including Mark Frost, Jennifer Lynch, Dana Ashbrook, Wendy Roby, and Catherine Coulson. A week before this seminar, the show revealed that Leland, possessed by Bob, had killed Laura Palmer. The moderator of the panel took a poll of the audience. She said, how many of you people knew the identity of the killer? Over half the attendees raised their hands. AKA, why, Lynch, do you want to keep something a mystery and a secret
right.
when over half the audience already knows?
Sure.
And listeners who weren't back in 1990, I want you to kind of figure out that you shouldn't be shocked by this. Nowadays, the audience is able to solve the big twist in a Mr. Robot season after the first episode. Like
uh-huh.
season 2 of Mr. Robot, people watched it and then went online, oh, I bet this is the big twist. And they were exactly right. They actually did the same thing in season 1.
Yeah.
In seasons 1 and 2 of True Detective, online peeps have solved the mystery within the first 2 episodes. They're like, oh, doesn't that person look interesting? And
yeah.
so, yes, this is nowadays where you have the internet, you have Reddit, you have theories, and so everybody's able to spread them quickly. But 1990, the internet wasn't what
Sorry,
it is
today. Sorry, I'm
just
trying to, I can't even remember what happened in True Detective season 2.
You're better off that way.
Sorry.
But let me say, in 1990, the internet wasn't what it is now, but there were still bulletin boards, there were still user groups. And once again, we had months to go over this stuff. The first season had a bunch of clues. And then over that summer, Laura's Secret Diary was released, the book
mm-hmm.
that Jennifer Lynch wrote. By the time Twin Peaks was back, and by the time they revealed the killer in November, most people had kind of knew it was Leland,
uh-huh.
and then the people who weren't sure it was Leland
yeah.
certainly had Leland among their top suspects. How can you have a mystery if everybody knows the answer?
Right, exactly. And they tipped their hand. They tipped their hand in a lot of different ways. And so if they're going to do that, they could have revealed and. Or maybe they didn't need to reveal it. Maybe the story went another direction, and for whatever reason, it didn't matter anymore. But the fact is, so many people knew who killed her. I mean, a big reason is episode 1 of season 2, Leland shows up, and oh, by the way, just like Bob, he's got a full head of white hair. And, well, maybe, you know, Bob didn't have full head of white hair, but
yeah,
but
no.
that was something that happened, and that didn't happen over the course of a month. That happened in the show, in the story, overnight. So it's kind of like, hey, people, look at this guy really closely. Does he, you know, maybe does he resemble anyone else in the show? You know, to tip their hand and then to not have it be part of the story would just be a huge waste of time. I mean, yeah, I don't know what they're thinking.
Mork, I told this story when the Twin Peaks podcast had me on as a guest, but when the pilot started, I immediately suspected Big Ed for only one reason. Everett McGill, the actor who played Big Ed, was a werewolf in this great Stephen King film, Silver Bullet. But even, I immediately stopped suspecting him, and I was like, boy, Leland sure is weird. And sure enough, the clue, which the show never said was a clue, but the way I took it was a clue, is in the dream, Killer Bob says, "You may think I've gone insane, but I promised I will kill again."
Yeah.
Leland was obviously the character who had gone insane.
Right.
And then similarly, or who we thought had gone insane. Mm-hmm. Similarly, in those last couple episodes of season one, Leland watches Maddie sneak out of the house.
Yeah.
They specifically have a shot of Leland turning and watching Maddie sneak out of the house.
Yeah.
Then in that same episode, we see somebody watching, I think it's Bobby, and then later Dr. Jacoby, somebody watching them look at Maddie disguised as Laura.
Yeah.
Yet the show didn't show us who this was. But the only character it could have been was Leland. Everybody else was busy somewhere.
Right.
And Leland had watched Maddie leave.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have Leland kill Jock in the final episode of season one. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, obviously he beat up Dr. Jacoby. He was the one watching. Now they have him kill Jock. He's going to have to go to jail in the real life of the show. Two birds, one stone.
Mm-hmm.
Because he had gone insane, because so many clues from the dream pointed towards him. Before season one was over, I was positive it was Leland. Then Laura's secret diary gets released. You read that and about Bob, and it's a great book to read. But so much of Bob, B-O-B, D-A-D, you know, this was somebody who would get into her house and abuse her.
Right.
Who could it be?
Yeah, exactly.
We knew the answer. Back in 2000, I watched this series with my girlfriend at the time, the woman who ripped my heart out and removed all my emotions. This
Helen
girlfriend.
Hunt?
No. And what I loved watching with her, because she hadn't watched the original run, and she became as addicted in this marathon we did of Twin Peaks as I was back in a decade earlier. She'd ask me to stay up another hour to watch another episode. She was so excited about Twin Peaks. It was fun sharing this with her. Guess what? In a marathon, not just months, but in a marathon, you're right.
Yeah.
Leland's hair turns white. He's saying, you know, oh, I recognize this guy from the cabin out near Burl Lakes. Want to play with fire, little boy?
Right.
She figured it out.
Yeah.
Twin Peaks had shed millions of people from the audience, and those who stuck it around had solved the killer. You can't keep it a mystery anymore. Now I'm going to give you my sixth reason for why they were correct to reveal the killer. And let's get to this. And I think not enough people who say, oh, they never should have revealed the killer. They never should have revealed the killer. When they say that, I hope they're going against my number six reason, and I hope they understand what they're saying. We would never have some of the greatest episodes of television if they hadn't revealed the killer.
Right.
That episode, which revealed Leland killing Maddie, that entire episode is brilliant. It is one of the greatest episodes of all time.
Yeah, those two are
You mean the episode where Leland dies, too. Sorry,
episode. Yeah.
So I am telling you, those were great. That jazzed the remaining millions who watched the show. You know, it inspired them. It thrilled them. People were like, holy smokes, this is great. If you were alive back then, Stephen King had a weekly column in USA Today newspaper. In his weekly column after this episode, he just raved about Twin Peaks in this episode like there was no tomorrow.
Right.
And so you have to understand, I mentioned how those October episodes were just tanking so bad in the ratings. And then you had this reveal in November. It got everybody hyped. To have not revealed the killer, Twin Peaks needed something else to get people hyped. But they didn't. They hadn't built anything else in the story to get people hyped that could have a resolution. To have the idea that, you know, okay, the Twin Peaks got canceled at the end of season two and not reveal the killer until the end of season two. You mean drag out this murder mystery another 10 hours when they had already dragged it out 17 hours? It is crazy.
Right.
I loved those episodes so much. And, you know, we'll get to it as we review the entire series. That episode that revealed Leland looking in the mirror, seeing Bob.
Oh, yeah.
To me, it was the greatest moment ever. I still think about it today, how wonderful that episode was. They needed to do it then. They did it in a great way. You got to be crazy. What you mentioned, Mork, you've already mentioned it a couple times on previous podcasts. You say the episode where Leland died was one of the best moments for you.
Yeah, no, and it just, you know, simply put, you see grief, you see people being killed, but it really is it really is sort of like this guy's soul disintegrating. And, you know, he realizes what he's done, and he knows he'll never be able to make it right, and it's played perfectly. And, yeah, it's convenient that, you know, it's raining inside the cell because there's a fire and all that, but it's perfect. And part of that episode, don't forget, is part of that episode is Coop and everyone else talking about what could have happened. What possessed Leland to do this?
Yeah, the end of that episode, so strong.
It's so strong. And what's easier to believe, that a father could do this to his daughter or that an evil spirit did this? Like, what's better? Like, in, you know, really.
Yeah,
like,
that question I thought was brilliant when they asked it on the show.
Yeah. Also, it's necessary to reveal the killer and for Leland to die for, guess what? For Bob. Bob needs to get out of there. Bob needs to do something else.
It allowed the show to grow. Yeah. I mean,
well, it should have, and it could have. It was the right move.
Yes, and that leads us to reason 7, yeah. Mark. This is so important. In reason 7, why people like David Lynch are wrong, and I hate to say it so much since I'm just, you know, praising to high heaven the episode that he directs where he reveals the killer.
I hope he doesn't listen to this podcast.
I hope he does. I mean, he needs to wise up. Okay. So listen, people who argue against solving the killer, they say it because they are misdiagnosing the problem, if you consider there is a problem. But the problem with the second season, it wasn't that solving the killer didn't kill the show. What killed the show is that Twin Peaks didn't follow the true soap opera that it was in its story breakdowns and rhythms. The show had everything invested in who killed Laura Palmer, and in everything that wasn't involved with who killed Laura Palmer. All the other storylines were busy getting lower and lower stakes.
Yeah.
Twin Peaks was a soap opera, but in this one instance, in that one moment in the second season, it didn't operate like a soap opera should in story structure. So soap operas are obviously ongoing. They never end. Yet soap operas, like any other story, do need to give resolutions to satisfy the viewer. So how does a soap opera, which never ends, give resolutions? They have multiple storylines. They're all operating at different arcs. Yes, one story may be reaching its peak and reaching its resolution. But as soon as it reaches its resolution, another storyline is ramped up and going for another storyline.
Yeah.
If you watch Game of Thrones, and Game of Thrones, based on a really good set of books written by a guy who used to write for TV, he's great about this, about how one storyline, ooh, a character can die, and that can end an episode. And you think, well, why keep watching? And
has
yet
anyone
other
died
story-
in Game of Thrones?
Spoiler alert. No. But, you know, in other words, the storylines keep going. You're not just pulled into one storyline.
Yeah.
But look at all of the storylines, where they were in that episode where Leland died in a cell, the episode that you were just praising, Mark, that was so good. So let's look at the Mill storyline, which had always been the other storyline not tied to Laura Palmer.
Okay.
Guess what? At that point, it was over. Ben had sold the lands back to Catherine. That story was over. Thanks. Josie, the third triangle of the Ghostwood Estates, she had left town.
Oh,
she
okay.
wasn't around. The storyline was over. There was nothing to ramp up.
Yeah.
You know, there was other storylines like, hey, remember the love triangle of Donna, Maddie, and James?
Yeah, but I don't want to.
Well, it is a storyline.
Yeah.
But of course, if one of the members of Love Triangle dies, guess what? That storyline, over. And to be honest, James had decided he and Donna were the one.
Right.
So the storyline was over. There was nothing there.
Exactly.
Remember how Audrey, she had been kidnapped at One-Eyed Jack's and her life was in peril? Well, guess what? She had been rescued. She was safe. Remember how Audrey was about to find out her dad's big secret and, ooh, that leads to a giant cliffhanger.
Yeah.
At this point, she knew his secret. She was safe at home. Storyline was over. How about Big Ed and Norma's affair? There's a storyline, right?
Uh-huh.
Guess what?
Yeah, sure.
In the episodes, right around revealing Leland kills Maddie and Leland dies, during that point, Ed and Norma, they're on a break. It's advancing, not receding. And when you understand receding, not advancing. Now, I talk about lowering the stakes. Now, I want to look specifically at one storyline. In the first season, Shelley Johnson, she's having an illicit affair, but she's afraid of being caught by her murderous, jealous husband. Dun, dun, dun. Those are what we call high stakes. Any moment could be wrought with danger. Oh my goodness, what's going to happen to Shelley?
Sure.
Now, as the Laura Palmer, who killed Laura Palmer storyline is wrapping up, what was Shelley's stakes? She didn't have enough money to support her and her vegetable comatose husband. Now, I'm not saying there isn't drama in a woman not having enough money to live and having a comatose husband.
Yeah.
But there isn't an immediate threat of being caught and killed. The stakes are just much lower.
Yeah.
And that's what they did with so many storylines. So when Lynch and with other people talk about, oh, killing Laura's would killed all the momentum and it got lost. Really? Yes, you can dislike the season two storylines, but at that specific moment after they revealed the killer, none of the storylines had any stakes. None of them had any momentum. What are we supposed to say?
Yeah, it took
M.T. Wentz, the restaurant critic. Ooh, what could happen there? Oh, right. Hank just ran
Hank
in.
Hank and Ernie.
Right, Hank and Ernie's day
Hank
off.
Hank and Ernie's scams.
Right.
Hank and Ernie's Coke scams. Well, I want to say two things. I'm going to give you reason number eight. We're all proving here together why Lynch is wrong. Because we know who killed Laura, and we're 25 years later, we're still talking about the damn show.
That is the best reason.
And there's going to be a third one, and guess what? We still know who killed Laura, and they're coming back to do a third show. So hopefully what they're going to do this year, starting May 21st on Showtime, steal it, sign up, subscribe, whatever you got to do. But what they're going to do is what they should have been doing in, you know, starting in season two, in the beginning of season two. So when we knew who killed Laura, they could keep going. But then we wouldn't be here today. So, you know, I'm glad they did what they did.
Right. So I want to piggyback on that. You know, here I was just dissing poor Shelley and her comatose, you know, her comatose husband, Leo. Maddie is killed in one episode. We have an episode of Cooper not realizing that Leland was the killer. Then we have a third episode in that November sweeps where Cooper catches Leland. Leland dies. What if in that episode in between, what if then Leo had come out of his coma and attacked, and the stakes had suddenly gone back up?
Sure.
Then the stakes would have been risen, and then you would have been like, oh my God, okay, we know who killed Laura Palmer, and okay, now Leland's dead, but oh my God, Leo Johnson's about to kill Shelley. I have to keep watching. What's going on?
Well, I want to suggest two things. One is that something you said just kind of triggered this in my mind. What if Earl showed up a lot earlier? And if all they needed to do was tie in solving Laura to Earl, or Earl helps Coop get a clue, but also that's part of Earl's trap. So one, that could have been a fun way to go.
Amen. Another, I agree 100%.
Another way to go would have been to, you know, the audience, you know, the audience is smart. The audience is paying attention. A lot of people knew. I mean, this is going to sound, I'm going to sound like a horrible son by saying this, but my mom knew who killed Laura, and it was only because of the hair, and she knew it. And because, you know, basically, and she was like, and I was like, how did you know? And she called it as soon as she saw it. And I was piecing it together, but she called it, and I was like, well, that doesn't make any sense. How would you know? And it's like, oh, well, because your aunt Rigoberta, her hair turned white, and we found out it's because, you know, she had sold her cat and she lied to her kids about it having died, or, you know, some ridiculous thing. Anyway, not a short declarative sentence. I apologize. But what they could have done is simply Leland could have died.
Yeah.
They could reveal to the audience without it being an official, you know, an official case closed. It could have remained an open case legally. The audience would have known, and they could have kept going. And what they might have done also is, I don't know if you ever saw Pledge, which is a Sean Penn directed movie.
With Jack Nicholson.
It's depressing. But spoiler alert, Jack Nicholson pledges, he's a cop on his last day, a little girl is murdered, and he pledges to her parents that he's going to figure out who killed her. And we know what happens, but Jack Nicholson never does. And Jack Nicholson, by the end of the movie, begins a descent into madness because he doesn't solve the crime. So maybe what they could have done was revealed to the audience that it was Leland and how and why. But for Truman and for Coop
right.
and for the rest of the heroes,
yes.
they'll start to go insane, and that could drive the show for who knows how long.
What if Leland disappears into the woods and they don't catch him? They know he's the killer, but he's out there somewhere in the woods and could strike at any moment. The stakes are still high.
The stakes are still high, and it's going to tie to everything else that they're going to do.
Right. I mean, they tried that with Bob. Bob's still out there. He's this lurking presence. And so they tried it with Bob. The point is that revealing the killer didn't kill the show.
Yeah, yeah.
And I want to jump to, we got some great feedback from a couple fans on this. Joel Bacco, who is at Lost in the Movies. If you guys are on Twitter at all, you should know Joel. I call him a Twin Peaks historian. I put this question out there. Hey, we're going to do this podcast. And this was his reason. He says, number one, he believes that revealing the killer did kamikaze the series from an artistic long-term narrative storyline. And he goes, he agrees with Lynch on that, especially the way in which it was done, putting a capper on the entire Laura storyline and taking the show in a very different direction that frankly didn't make much sense in light of the original pilot. Not that this mattered much, but since the show was going to be canceled anyway, it could have gone out more gracefully and cohesively had it allowed the murder to stay its course. So he says, but then on the flip side, he agrees with us. He says it brought Twin Peaks to its highest points. He goes, where he differs from Lynch, he thinks killing the bulk of the show yielded several pearls worth, you know, revealing that. He says episodes 14 and 29, as well as Fire Walk With Me, he considers those the highest points of the series. And of course, episode 14 is in this arc, revealing the killer. Mm-hmm. And he says nothing else compares to that. Furthermore, all of Lynch's later films, which are his favorite in Lynch's filmography, seem to be born out of the crisis that happened in Twin Peaks. He says Mulholland Drive seems impossible to imagine without Twin Peaks going where it did. These efforts were only made possible by the decision to reveal the killer. So in that sense, it is sort of a noble sacrifice. Killing the goose, sure, Lynch, but yielding the most golden eggs. That's one of his reasons. He had two other. Okay. Joel says he thought revealing the killer exposes the dark heart of the series. In what may be called a moral sense, Lynch's occasional suggestion that the killer never should have been revealed would have robbed the show of its most powerful feature. That mostly doesn't come out until the movie, in his opinion, but it's implicit in episode 14, and it lends a great deal of shock value. It elevates Twin Peaks to another level beyond a fun murder mystery that the show already was. Joel writes, granted, this could theoretically have come through the final episode of the series, but he doesn't think it would have been good just postponing it. Joel's final point is he said that revealing the killer expanded the mythology and it made season 3 possible, like you just said, Mork. He said, granted, the show might have been able to grow and deepen its mythos if the Palmer mystery had been kept ongoing, but it seems that the Lodge stuff and Cooper's personal crisis emerged only because we knew who killed Laura. If the show had ended with the reveal, that would be it. Only because it was allowed to stumble, fall on its face, and get back up and brush itself off did Twin Peaks grow beyond the initial premise. He says, this is about a show dying a glorious death. It's about a phoenix rising from those ashes. So those were Joel's points. He said the negative about revealing the killer as well as the positive. Pretty good, huh?
Sounds like he's trying to have it both ways.
Well, you know, I could, once again, this could be both sides. If you disagree with us, we would prefer you don't unsubscribe. We'd prefer you go to our Facebook page and listen, we'll read it on the air.
Yeah.
We also got a great comment from Laughing Pinecone. So why don't you read this one, Mork?
Okay. Laughing Pinecone says, I also agree that it was right to reveal Laura's killer, and I even like the concept of the reveal as it happened, i.e. Laura solves the case herself. Disagree with pretty much all the writers' room's choices of what to do with those characters afterwards. Ideally for me, in general, I would have pushed most of them into storylines related to various consequences of the murderer's identity or to finding closure. Still orbiting around Laura for the time being, still exploring grief and disruption. Really wish we could know exactly how they were thinking they could sustain an ongoing series. Like, long-term plans, what were they? We know that Laura's case should have been phased out, then what?
Okay.
So yeah, so that's, yeah, so there's some good points in there. And I think that, I mean, so much of what we've been talking about, whether it's in the book or Fire Walk With Me, or, you know, it really is about the expansion of the mythology of the town. And this really is a very unique, special place. We know from the minute we set foot in Twin Peaks, this is a very fun, interesting, strange, but also the way that the wind moves through the trees, it's a dark place.
Oh, yeah.
Why is it dark? And that exploring that is a lot of fun, and there's more to as awful and as horrifying as Laura's death was, it's not the only dark thing going on there. Dark things have been happening there for hundreds of years. And in Eastern or Western or Northern or Southern Washington State. So that much we know. And so moving on, and like you're saying, you know, like they do so well in Game of Thrones, from one big event to the next big event, it would have been great to see. But yeah, revealing the killer had nothing to do with why the show ended.
Okay. So we've talked about why they revealed the killer. Now we're going to do the very incongruous thing and go back and look at the pilot.
Look at the pilot.
And the first episode.
Why don't you start? You're going to do the pilot.
All right.
And you're going to talk about the best moment.
The best minute.
The best minute.
Right.
Excuse me. The best minute. And then
the worst minute.
Okay. Good luck with that.
And then you're going to do the same for the episode after the pilot.
I promise you I will.
We got to get ready for season three. So we're going to do this every week. We're going to look at two episodes of Twin Peaks and give our best and worst minutes, excuse me, from each. And then we want you guys to join in and play. This is based, I say, lovingly ripped off from Star Wars Minute. Now, what they do on the Star Wars Minute podcast is say the Star Wars movie Attack of the Clones is 244 minutes long. They actually do 244 podcasts and one about each minute of the movie. It takes a whole year to do a movie. It's actually very fun. If you're into Star Wars, they always liven it up. But it really allows them to go deep. We don't have that much time before season three, so we're going to just kind of steal it off and look at the best and worst minutes. And sure enough, Mork, I'm going to go to the pilot. What would you prefer to hear, Mork? Do you want to hear the best minute in the Twin Peaks pilot, or do you want to hear what the worst 60 seconds, the worst minute in the pilot is?
I want you to start with the best.
The Twin Peaks pilot, Mork, is wonderful.
It is.
In our next podcast, we're going to look at the next two episodes, but our essay in that podcast is going to be about Lynch's visual rhythm. Are there times when Lynch's slow is too slow?
Okay.
If you look at this pilot of Twin Peaks, some people may call it slow, and it's slow, but I would call it good slow. And even in its quote-unquote slowness, if you skip the 2 minutes and 30 worth of credit at the beginning of the pilot, which was longer than the usual credits, which were already pretty long, once the credits are over, if you watch the next 10 minutes, the first 10 minutes of the actual show, you're in the Packard house, the sheriff's station, back to the Packard's house, you go to the Palmer house, you go to the Briggs house, you go to the Twin Peaks High locker room, you go to the Great Northern. In the first 10 minutes, you meet Josie, Catherine, Pete, Lucy, Harry, Doc Hayward, Andy, Laura. You find out about Laura Palmer, Sarah Palmer. You meet Mr. and Mrs. Briggs. You see the high school coach, and you see Mike Nelson in the background. Maybe that doesn't count, but he's there. You see Ben Horn. You see Leland Palmer. You haven't seen Bobby, but he's been spoken about. That, to me, it's still nicely paced, but it's not what I would call painful Lynch slow, which we'll talk about in next week's podcast. But for me, to pick the best single minute in the Twin Peaks pilot, minute 48.
Okay.
It begins with Cooper saying, remove this key. We're going to run this envelope. It's the envelope from Laura's diary with the safety box deposit key in it. And it ends a minute later with Andy on the radio talking to Lucy. Tell Harry we found where it happens and where Ronette and Laura were taken and tortured. This 1 minute. Minute 48 of the Twin Peaks pilot, I believe, gives you the best of everything Twin Peaks had to offer. It starts with removing a key, Cooper believing that this envelope contains cocaine, Harry doubting that you didn't know Laura Palmer. It ends with a hilarious joke of, Diane, I'm holding in my hand a box of chocolate bunnies. And Lynch, to his credit, when he edits good, he edits good. You want to go out on a laugh. On a laugh, you edit. Perfect. He edits to the trees.
Right.
It's just an establishing shot of the trees, the wind blowing the mist, setting the mood. Then we go from that to the train car, and it starts on a pan where it looks like a posse, just a bunch of people with guns and dogs and all these people, and it pans over to that train graveyard. Lucy and Andy are talking. The lines go, Lucy? Andy, is that you? And Andy says that line where he's crying.
Yeah.
It gives you the best of everything. That minute, to me, is the best single minute, best 60 seconds in the entire Twin Peaks pilots. There are other great moments, but to be honest, some of them you can't break down to just 60 seconds.
Yeah.
And then there's goodness, but it's spread out too much. This, when you need 60 seconds of the Twin Peaks pilot, minute 48, the best minute in the pilot.
Hello.
That's what I'm saying. That's my case.
I'll take that minute. That's a good minute.
All right. Oh, boy.
Okay. And now we've the pilot got, is perfect.
No.
Let's go on to the second episode.
I'm sorry, Mork. Now we got to go to the thing which listeners feel free to disagree with. Right in.
I'm going to disagree.
We got to
right
pick
now.
The worst single minute, the worst 60 seconds in the pilot. And just as I, to be honest, I had a bunch of other good minutes I could have gone. I felt that was the best minute. In this worst case, I've only got two possible options. And I'm going to do something that is possibly, let me say this again, quite possibly blasphemous. I'm going to say the worst single minute in the Twin Peaks pilot is from 2 minutes 44 seconds to 3 minutes 44 seconds, a.k.a. the very beginning of Twin Peaks, after that 2 minutes worth of credits.
Right.
Why am I being tough on this minute?
Because you're a jerk?
Maybe. Twin Peaks. When you talk to people about Twin Peaks, one of the first things anybody says is, she's dead, wrapped in plastic.
Yeah.
That is kind of like how everybody imagines, ooh, this is how the show starts. This is what gets going.
Right.
Those aren't the first words in Twin Peaks. That isn't the first image in Twin Peaks.
Yeah.
A great novel, a lot of times, people always go to the first line of a novel. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. People go to the first thing. The very first line in Twin Peaks is, going fishing.
What's wrong with that?
There's nothing special about it.
It's short, it's declarative.
Then,
he's taking a stand. The fish have been attacking
him. Then the second
in
line.
In the boat, out of the boat.
The second line
Pete's
of dialogue.
Standing up for himself.
The second line of dialogue in the Twin Peaks pilot. Lonesome foghorn blows. What is going on? Listen to me. I love Pete. I love moments. But the show, I believe, could have started stronger is if somehow, and admittedly this would take moving the line to before Lucy's hilarious Sheriff Truman, I'm transferring it to this phone routine, which is so great. But if the show could have found a way to have the very first words be, she's dead, wrapped in plastic, I think it would have been stronger. I also want to go to this minute, and I'm going to say something else that is blasphemous. The very first image in the show, to be honest, I think it's a bunch of ducks floating outside the Packer house there on the lake. But a lot of people refer to the first shot as a shot of Josie looking into a mirror. Mm-hmm. And that does, considering the very last shot of the Twin Peaks television series of Cooper looking into a mirror that does create great symmetry.
Hmm.
But to me, that image of Josie looking into a mirror, to me, it doesn't represent the show well. So just like I feel the first line in a perfect world would be the greatest line ever, something like she's dead, wrapped in plastic,
I
whatever.
I will not complain
instead
about
of gone
any
fishing.
Minute of Joan Chen on film ever.
Josie Packard, great character. But when I think about Twin Peaks, maybe this is just me, she feels like such a side tangent. And so for me, I love this pilot. So when I'm picking a worst minute, know that I'm picking a minute I love. For me, the minute at the very beginning, worst minute in the Twin Peaks pilot. If you agree
Even
or disagree,
though you still love it.
I love this. I love this
you
pilot.
Just saved
I think this pilot is
punch
great.
In the belly.
But this is what you're going to have to do, listeners. We want you to kind of join with us. Tell us what your favorite minute, the best minute, and the last minute is.
I don't think there's a wasted minute in the pilot, and I really wouldn't change it.
My other choice, just so you know, my other choice, sure enough, did involve Pete, Josie, and Catherine. Mm-hmm. It was minutes and 33 seconds, and it actually features great kind of establishing dialogue by Mark Frost, where Josie says, Catherine, I'm sorry if this offends you, but I own the sawmill. And Catherine responds to, you don't know the first thing about this mill, that's why I'm running it. Boy, that is great, such kind of exposition
sure.
built in, but that
you
was
know
my
who
second
people
choice.
Are, you know, yeah, you know that you get their
you know,
relationship.
Let me say once again, there were other great minutes I could have chosen.
Yeah.
My second choice for best minute of the pilot was minute 36. It begins with Big Ed's truck pulling away from the gas farm. And then the next minute is Cooper's introduction, which ends with, that cherry pie is worth a stop.
Yeah.
But you miss so much of what happens continuing in that. And so best minute, once again, minute 48. Worst minute, even though it's still very good, the The least best minute is the least best. 2 minutes and 44 seconds to 3 minutes and 44 seconds. Mork.
Not the least best.
You did the second episode directed by Dwayne Dunham. Let's hear it.
Yeah, he did a great job. And there are a few things I didn't love about it. I was going to do just a best and just a worst, but because of your hedging, I'm going to add a third minute to my episode.
Oh, all right. Let's hear it.
Okay, so first let's start with the best.
The best.
Which is, it's between 3:59 and 4 minutes.
So 4 minutes into the episode.
Minute four on the counter.
Love it. Okay.
If you're watching on the DVD, who knows on Netflix, what the hell. But it's probably pretty close.
Okay.
Coop is already in the restaurant of the Great Northern. And he's had an fine cup of coffee.
Oh boy, this is a great minute. This is a great minute of this episode.
But he starts to order, and he orders his bacon, not just crispy, but what? Cremated.
Love that. I still use that line myself when I go.
He's ordering his meal, and after you order your meal, you need to have a delicious beverage to wash it down in addition to the damn fine coffee.
Yep.
And he wants some grapefruit juice. Provided that the grapefruits are cut to
Audrey Horne. Sherilyn Fenn. Oh, my Lord.
Walking into the restaurant.
Oh, man, how beautiful.
Freshly squeezed.
Oh, so inappropriate.
Inappropriate. But this also is a very telling minute of the show. She walks in. Coop immediately knows who she is. She introduces herself as Audrey Horne, but he immediately knows that she's Benjamin Horne's daughter. She asks if she can sit down. He says, well, if I'm correct, your dad owns this place, so you can do whatever the hell you want.
Man.
But it's also my pleasure. You get a sense from Coop as he introduces himself. I've never heard in the history of television or film or being under investigation myself personally, any FBI agent say more slowly, more deliberately, with more subtext, Federal Bureau of Investigation Special Agent Dale Coop. Like, it's so slow.
Man.
You get the sense of...
Is it a humble brag? It's a humble brag, agent of investigation.
It's a humble brag, but it's also, you get the sense of, you know, his love for institutions as well as...
His love for high school girls.
Barely legal young women.
That is a great minute.
And so you have, but also...
How does it end? What's the last thing in that 60-second span?
Well, the last thing is Audrey, he immediately asks if she was friends with Laura, and there's a great pause, and Audrey says, well, we weren't best friends or anything, but they did know each other. And then it ends with, it's almost a joke, and the scene doesn't end here. This is just where the minute ends. But it is sort of a nice little moment.
Let's see.
Because she tutors Johnny, my brother. He's 27, but he's in the third grade. So you get a little bit
great
of family.
Great exposition. Oh.
You get the family. You get the dynamic between them. She is clearly smitten with him. She is clearly turning on the charm, which we all love. She's my favorite character in the show. Maybe not the most important, but still my favorite. And you get them together. You get that interplay, which... thankfully did not get into that was as creepy as it got between them.
I want it creepier. She's so hot.
Well, but it does show Coop's predilection. It does show, you know, it does kind of foreshadow him falling for Annie, who can't be much older than Audrey.
Well, the actresses, believe it or not, Sherilyn Fenn was older than Heather Graham was.
Really?
Yeah. Even though one was supposed to play a high school student, one was somebody who was out of a convent, you would assume was older. Yeah.
Right. That was my favorite minute, one of my favorite minutes of the whole show.
I wanted to mention, in your minute, who is Cooper talking to? He's talking to Great Northern waitress Trudy.
Hell yeah.
Trudy played by the wife of Twin Peaks writer and second season, one of the replacements of Frost and Lynch, Bob Engels. Robert Engels' wife plays Trudy.
I did not know that.
Boy, that is a great minute.
I did have a complaint. My one complaint.
Oh, no. About the best minute in the entire episode? Boy, this is... Okay.
If you watch the episode, right over Coop's shoulder is a lumberjack or some sort wearing a big red hat that says Canada on it. And this guy,
really?
You would think this guy is that has discovered a clue and in solving Laura's murder, because he is in such a rush to get out of there. He slams a cup of coffee. He shoves a whole pancake in his mouth.
All
he's
right.
salting something with one hand. He's putting maple syrup on.
This was
another.
That actor's big break, yeah. Mork. Don't
he,
joke. Don't
he
joke.
He did not let it go. So maybe he'll be in season three. We don't know.
Great minute. Great minute.
So that the high is going to meet the low.
Uh-oh.
Where is the low? I'll tell you where.
I want to know.
In the general
this is
store.
Still, oh, no.
When is the low? 21 minutes, 15 seconds in. What happens? Well, Norma's going into the store for something, and she bumps into, oh, hello, Nadine. What's up? So you were talking about a little while ago about the story of the woman who tries to
invent silent drape
runners. Silent drape runners with some cotton balls and kills herself or tries to kill herself. Well, this is Nadine picking up not just the cotton balls, the cotton balls. So
oh boy.
It's a lot of work for relatively little pay. And it's just painful interaction. There's no real hint of the drama between them or the jealousy between them at that point.
Right.
And it's just not a minute that I really ever enjoyed.
Mork, can I say the one thing I do like about that scene in your worst minute of that episode is that so much of Twin Peaks after the pilot, once they started producing these episodes proper, takes place on sound stages here in Los Angeles. It was actually up in Van Nuys in the Valley.
Huh.
That scene actually took place on location, and I still always have a bit of I have a bit of warmth for that scene, which your worst minute is in, because they actually filmed it on location. But I'm certainly willing to accept that as minute of the episode.
I don't feel bad that general store has been turned into condos. So now I'm going to add a third minute.
We're off the rails. All right, let's hear it.
What I just talked about was my worst minute, definitely my least favorite minute.
Yeah.
But it's not the minute I'm most disappointed in.
Okay.
And so I'm not angry at this minute. I'm just disappointed in it.
Oh, no.
And it starts at 37 minutes in and 40 seconds. So we're almost at the very end of the show.
Sure.
And we have some very important characters, one of whom you met in person, and the other features extremely prominently in everything else we've been talking about on this podcast, because he is the archivist. A major Garland Briggs.
And you're disappointed by a scene between Bobby and his father?
I am.
Major Garland Briggs?
I'm sitting because we're getting straight dope. We're
all
getting
right.
the straight dope from Garland Briggs. He's talking about it's important to rebel and it's a sign of strength, and I respect the fact that you're doing it. I understand that you don't want to enter into a dialogue with me. I mean, the fact how Briggs talks to his son is fantastic, and it does definitely speak to somebody who's very aware of the spiritual side of man, the spiritual nature, the problems that come with that, all of that. Like, all that is so clear.
Right.
But this is episode two, and we don't know who killed Laura Palmer. We do know that he was her public boyfriend.
Right.
And, you know, we learned some other stuff, particularly about James, and we're going to learn about a lot of other people. But this is a moment where when you look back at it, in the pilot, where Bobby and Mike and James are in the jail cell together, I remember watching this, and Bobby and Mike just start barking at James.
Oh, heck yeah. And howling like an ape mad.
And I remember thinking, what the hell? Like, what are these guys doing? Like, this, I was like, these guys, you got to watch out for these. These guys. Unfortunately, very quickly that tension is completely removed, partially by Cooper in a great moment, and this happens right before this, so this is more than a third minute. But Coop and Truman let Mike and Bobby go, and Coop, you know, he plays just right, and he's like, oh, by the way, guys, pray for the health and safety of James Hurley, because if, you know, anything happens to him, come for you. So basically it's like, all right, you know, the FBI guy is not going to let these punks get away with anything. And then we see him at the table being lectured by his dad, who is a cool guy.
Oh, yeah.
Who is a cool guy. And he acts like a damn punk. And it immediately removes him from being in my mind, someone who could be a real villain on the show. Someone who could be a serious...
He can't be a serious threat because...
He doesn't... Yeah, the way that he acts is not a serious threat. So it could have been cool, you know, just sort of watching it. If he played up to that, if he basically was shining his dad on and responding and, "You're right, Dad, I'm so disappointed in myself, da-da-da-da-da." Like, if...
What if he had turned and said, "Dad..."
I would have accepted that. But like, he was, it would have been cool. Someone with the wherewithal, with the intellect, was potentially going to use it for evil. We see that obviously at the end of the show with Wyndham Earle. But Bobby, I think, could have been a much more compelling potential villain in the show if he had acted, you know, a little more interesting than just roll his eyes at, "Oh, Dad, whatever." Like that, you know, like that kind of stuff. He didn't live up to that scene.
All right. So you've said the best minute, the worst minute, and the most disappointing minute.
Right.
Interesting. We had that caveat. Everybody, once again, go to our Facebook page, facebook.com/doublepodcasts. We want you to tell us. Tell us for the pilot and for this episode known as Traces to Nowhere in some quarters. On our next podcast, we're going to be doing the best minute and the worst minute from the episode known as Zen or The Skill to Catch a Killer. That's the one which features Cooper's dream. It's directed by David Lynch, written by Mark Frost and David Lynch. And we're also going to be going over the best and worst minute in the episode known as Rest in Pain, directed by Tina Rathborn, written by Harley Payton.
Yeah, interesting.
Also, our essay in next week's podcast is once again me being a bit anti-Lynch. We hope you're open-minded enough to accept that.
You? Impossible.
We're going to be talking about Lynch's pace and when slow is way too slow, deadly slow, I call it. And we want to know if you ever find some of Lynch's work, and I'll, just so you know, I'm going to be going outside of Twin Peaks on some of this too dreadfully slow. But that's next week. Please keep giving us those iTunes reviews and liking our Facebook page. We are going to be giving away some of these wonderful prizes we picked up at the David Lynch Festival of Disruption next week in our first February podcast. Give us a written review. That's all you have to do. Give us a written review in iTunes and like our Facebook page. You'll be eligible to win. The person who won our first prizes, the t-shirt and coasters we got at the Festival of Disruption, they live in Australia. They receive the prizes. It took a month to mail them there. If you're John Partimore, a.k.a. John Part-Timer, once again, contact us on our Facebook page and tell us where to mail your copy of The Secret History of Twin Peaks, autographed by Mark Frost and Amy Shields.
Do we want to mention some of our pals on Facebook and what they need to do over on Facebook?
Oh, yeah. So once again, please like our Facebook page. And we got some very nice comments on Facebook. Start us off, Mork.
Well, Andrea Hudson says that very happy to have found some more Peaks geeks. Thank you. I'm loving your discussion about the secret history and looking forward to more.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. We also got some great notes from Bad Ideas as well as Thomas Clapper, who said he's a Twin Peaks newbie and it's a joy to have discovered the Gifted in the Dam podcast. He thinks that our discussions are well thought out and add a light to his day. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And he says, I do not think the quality of the show dipped 1% after the reveal of the killer. Ooh, that's going to go into our discussion today. Thank you so much, Thomas.
That is very interesting. That is very, very interesting.
And we have this final one from John on the Facebook page. John says, just discovered your Twin Peaks podcast. Totally digging it. Glad to finally find someone else who enjoyed the Mark Frost book. Oh, hey, thank you so much.
Yeah. He thinks there's only three people who enjoyed the book?
No, go to Goodreads. A lot of positive reviews. And even though we were critical of it at times and we kept calling out those infamous inconsistencies, we enjoyed it. We hope you guys did too.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
For everyone here on Twin Peaks, the Gifted
and the Damned,
you can find me, Bubba, on Twitter at Fit and Trim. That's FitenTrim at Fit and Trim on Twitter.
Extraordinary to find Mork. That's extraordinary with a W in front of the final ultimate R.
We'll see you next time, member of the Damned Nation.
Is this thing on? 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 This thing on.